Well, now to an amazing story of survival in the last few days of World War II in Europe. A young Jewish woman called Malka was about to die in the gas chambers of a Nazi concentration camp when she was given a last-minute reprieve. Decades later, she spoke of the moment that left... that her life was spared and what happened afterwards. Let's have a listen.
In the line, the Dutch woman came in and she said, "I have good news for you. You're not going to die. You're going to go to America." They let us out and they were shooting. We shouldn't tell people what's going on there. We shouldn't get to Sweden and tell them what's going on, that they kill people for nothing, like flies. So they were shooting us. Whoever survived, survived.
Now, she was freed with around 1,000 women, and that had a serious repercussions, or had serious repercussions for Adolf Hitler. Malka's son, Stan Goldman, has pieced together her story for his latest book, and Stan joins us now from Los Angeles. It's great to see you, Stan.
No, thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us. Wow, what an extraordinary story, and such turmoil that your mother was put through. Why was she spared from death in Germany? How exactly did that happen?
Well, she was in some respects spared more than once, but the last time, the one you're talking about, it was a very strange sort of bargain with the devil. There was the World Jewish Congress had a representative in Sweden, and Himmler, the head of the SS, the second in command of all of Nazi Germany, also had a representative of his own sitting in neutral Stockholm in Sweden, and they had met. And they arranged a meeting, of all things, with Heinrich Himmler. Himmler, of course, wanted to keep it completely secret, even from Hitler, especially from Hitler. And they arranged for a secret middle-of-the-night meeting in Germany. So this representative, with 2 hours' notice, not knowing he would be picked to go, of the World Jewish Congress, a Jewish furrier, about 44 years old, gets on an airplane with a big Nazi swastika on, leaves neutral Sweden, flies into Berlin to meet in the middle of the night with Heinrich Himmler, who deludedly kind of believed that if he made a deal with some maybe Jews to release a few Jews, maybe some of his massive sins during the war might be forgiven in the post-war world. It was quite delusional because there was no one more responsible for the conduct of the Holocaust than was Heinrich Himmler. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was in charge of the SS camps. He was in charge of the death camps and the concentration camps. So this was really, you know, deluded on his part to believe this. But he, as part of the deal, he cuts as a gesture of good faith to the Jews and to the West. He agrees to free 1,000 Jewish women from a death camp that's only about 30 kilometers from where the meeting is taking place. Wow. It was the only death camp actually on German territory.
And
my mother is one of those selected to leave. You know, they didn't take all the Jews from the camp. They picked 1,000 women. It was a camp, by the way, only of women. A few men had been placed in the camp in the latter part of the war, but for the most part, it was the world's largest women's prison is actually what this camp was. And she was one of the women there who had survived so far and was picked out in those last weeks when they were still killing people. They were still gassing Jews in that camp.
Wow. Extraordinary. Stan, I can certainly relate to your book. My dad was a Holocaust survivor, a Polish Jew who actually spent time in Auschwitz. And so I was riveted with your book. And you've written that Hitler's death and your mum's freedom were actually linked. How was that?
Well, Himmler cuts this deal with the West. It then has to be negotiated through a Swedish emissary who is the head of the Red Cross in Sweden, Count Bernadotte. And Count Bernadotte arranges for buses to come and pick the women up at this camp. And he also agrees, when asked by Himmler as part of this deal, that he will deliver a message to the West that Himmler is interested in maybe cutting his own peace deal. Mm-hmm. And the West, of course, turns him down, but the word of it leaks out. And the word of it eventually reaches Hitler in his bunker. And historians, you know, have written that the learning of Himmler's betrayal was a direct cause of why Heinrich Himmler, why Adolf Hitler, learning of Heinrich Himmler's betrayal, Hitler chose that day to kill himself. So it has a direct impact on it.
Stan, it is such an extraordinary story, and you feel awful even just hearing these stories. How does a Holocaust survivor like your mum deal with what has happened to her? And what is it like for you as her son to see your mother dealing with these monstrous things that must no doubt still haunted her?
Well, I'll leave myself out of it. I think the fact that after all these years I decided to research the issue and write a book about it and tell everybody about it is probably my issue. But it's hard to say how anybody survives such a thing. There were survivors, and there's a line in Isaac Singer, who won a Nobel Prize for Literature, has a short story in which the narrator, who's basically Isaac Singer himself of the story, says that he meets with Holocaust survivors all the time, and one day he says, it's a lot like a picture I once saw of like antelope on the plains in Africa, and a tiger attacks, or a lion rather, and kills one, and they run and they run and they run, and after a while they stop and they start to graze, and I think that happens to people too. I think you just, at some point, you're alive and you have to make a choice. Either you decide to kill yourself, or you go on living. And my mother went on living, always remembering, never forgetting. It always, hung over her in terms of her attitudes towards everything. As I like to say, to my mother, there were only two sides to any argument. There was her side, and there were the Nazis. She only saw the world in blacks and whites because of what she'd been through. That was always the way she saw it, and she was always fearful. She always believed that danger was lurking. She was very suspicious of all sorts of things. Obviously, she'd spent 6 years under Nazi control. But also, by the way, I will tell you, convinced that that almost nothing could kill her. Because she had, as she once said to me, Stanley, well, she was ill at this point in time. She didn't die. I was worried about her. It was some time before she passed away, but I was worried about her. And she looked at my face and saw that I was worried about her and said, Stanley, don't worry. Hitler couldn't kill me. This won't.
Stan's book is called Left to the Mercy of a Rude Stream, The Bargain That Broke Adolf Hitler and Saved My Mother. What a fascinating story. Stan Goldman, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks so much, Stan.
Thank you.